Dear ladies and gentlemen, the topic of my presentation today is a compact full-bridge silicon carbide module for EV charger applications. My name is Max-Josef Kell, and I work at Danfoss Silicon Power at the Munich R&D Center located in Ismaning, Germany. For today's talk, I have prepared the following agenda. I would start off with the introduction, then move on to the key specifications and actual module design. Then I would like to share our approach on virtual prototyping of modules and include some of the relevant application scenarios in this case. I would end the presentation with a final slide on the conclusions. Danfoss Silicon Power is a producer of customized power modules and stacks. To give a brief introduction to the company, I would like to highlight few facts and numbers. Today, the company counts around 500 employees, most of them located and working at the main manufacturing site in Flensburg in the north of Germany. At the end of 2018, another manufacturing site has been added. It is located in the United States, in the state of New York, in Utica. In the same year, in Munich, a R&D competence center has been opened that is purely focusing on the research and development around fast switching and especially silicon carbide modules. As Danfoss Silicon Power is a supplier to various car manufacturers and suppliers, the company is fully certified according to automotive standards. With an increasing request for more localization regarding the production and the delivery of products, Danfoss Silicon Power has expanded its global manufacturing footprint. Besides the main production site in Flensburg, there has been the addition of the manufacturing site in Utica in the state of New York, and there are also plans to open a manufacturing site in Asia and China. But due to the COVID crisis, those plans are currently postponed. Danfoss Silicon Power has divided its business into three segments. There are the renewable segment, the industrial, and the automotive segment. The product that I am presenting here falls within the industrial category since it is targeted at stationary charging stations and not at a mobile application such as an onboard charger that would need to be certified according to automotive standards. Moving on to some of the key specifications of the module. Within the compact footprint of just 45 millimeters by 107 millimeter, the module offers a full H-bridge topology. The chips are rated for a voltage of 1200 volt, and the thermal limit of the single switch inside the package is at a 130 amperes rated current. The chipset that is currently in use is a third generation silicon carbide MOSFET of an industrial type, and four of them are in parallel per each switch. This results starting from the single MOSFET RDS(on) of 32 milliohm to a complete module RDS(on) for a single switch of just 8 milliohm, all at a temperature of 25 degrees Celsius. The module is also available with an NTC temperature sensor, and it uses for a robust handling and a good thermal performance a copper base plate and a thin DCB ceramic. Of course, as it applies to all of our modules, it is fully customizable to your application. To give an insight into the module design process, first we have started off by formulating several design targets. One of these targets, as this is a multi-chip silicon carbide module with several, in this case, four chips being in parallel per each switch, one target is clearly to have balanced inductances and balanced interconnections. On the right-hand side, we can see how the inductances and how the balancing was implemented in the final module layout. The parts that are the terminals that are part of the hot loop, which is the commutation loop between the DC link capacitor and the module switches, They are located in a symmetry around the vertical and around the horizontal axis. This forms a very good initial symmetry when the current enters the module, and that same symmetry is kept as the current is passing through the high side and the low side chips. This was our solution to form a good initial symmetry that helps to support a good current sharing among the silicon carbide chips. Another target was to use virtual prototyping to fully analyze the behavior of the hardware prototypes. This allowed us in an agile way to have a short iteration time between a hardware prototype and the next revision with improved changes due to the outcome of the measurements and the virtual prototyping that was ongoing at the same time. It allowed us to predict and even to understand and shape the parasitics of the module layout in such a way that they are beneficial to the module performance. We can say after this iterative process that the final design is the best, the optimized version out of three prototypes, where each of these prototypes also was built in multiple variants. The virtual prototyping helped us greatly in determining the final module properties regarding the loop inductances, especially the gate and power loop, and also understanding and shaping the couplings, the capacitive, the conductive, and magnetic couplings that are present inside such a dense and compact power module design. This slide exemplifies the approach we take within Danfoss Silicon Power towards virtual prototyping of power modules. We combine the digital domain with the physical domain, meaning we bring together the simulation result with actual measurement result of real hardware prototypes. To build a good model in the simulation environment, a key item is the parasitic extraction, for example, using a tool such as ANSYS Q3D and the actual power module design. Then the parasitic elements are combined with a chip model in a SPICE-based simulation environment. And this, together with the application knowledge of our application experts, forms and develops an understanding of what the needs and the requirements of the certain application are. Then after the first iteration that only happens in the digital domain, the first hardware prototype is being built. When this prototype is fully measured, of course, the feedback into the digital domain needs to happen. That means the measurement results have to be combined and compared with the simulation result to fully understand the behavior and to see if the two domains are matching. This helps in this case scenario to access signals that otherwise could not have been measured. On this slide, there are two waveforms being displayed. The green line is the measured gate source voltage of a device during a turn-off process at nominal conditions. We can see that the green line has heavy oscillations and ringing, so it tells us very little about the actual chip voltages present directly at the chip gate source. If we combine the measured values with the digital domain, with the simulation result, we can get a much clearer understanding of the behavior and of the voltages directly at the chip gate source. This is what the red line shows us. This is the simulated gate source voltage of the chip number 5 inside this power module. So by combining those two domains, we can have a much better inside view into what is happening in the power module. This helps to assess the term that is currently often being referred as the gate SOA. That is to determine whether the chip voltages are still inside and the maximum or the minimum allowable gate source voltages. This especially is a topic for gate oxide reliability. The manufacturers today impose strict limits that must be kept at all times. Combining measurements and simulation helps us to understand whether we are still inside the gate SOI or already exceeding it. Moreover, it helps to assess how close the module is to a parasitic turn-on by making visible the actual gate voltages at the chips itself. Besides, during the design process, it moreover helps to understand the couplings inside the gate circuit that are influenced by the power module layout. These are just few aspects. There's more helping elements that come due to the combination of the physical with the digital domain. Altogether, a module cell inductance of just 15 nanohenry is reached. If combined with a low inductive environment, this allows to unlock the full potential of the silicon carbide chips. The waveform displayed on the slide is at a nominal condition, and it reaches a DIDT of more than 8 kiloamperes per microsecond and a DVDT value of 25 kilovolt per microsecond. All of this while still controlling the overshoot to very acceptable values. So if combined in a low inductive environment, the module can be driven at high switching speeds, resulting in low switching losses. Regarding the application scenarios, I would like to highlight two topologies. For the target application in stationary charging, a galvanic separation is needed between the grid side and the electric vehicle due to regulations and due to safety reasons. This galvanic separation can be formed by a medium frequency transformer, as it is the case in the dual active bridge. Due to the full bridge design of the module, with just two of these modules, a dual active bridge topology can be realized, both primary and secondary side being active switches. The other topology would be a series resonant converter that only requires one side to be an active switch and moreover can offer a soft switching behavior. Here in the series resonant, the low on-state losses of this module play an important role. In both cases, power transfers of up to 50 kilowatts are possible. To conclude my presentation, Danfoss has designed a new full-bridge silicon carbide module in a compact footprint. The target application for this module is the DC to DC conversion stage of a charging station. Of course, this is not the only possible application for this module. It can be used in an active front end, serving as an active rectifier, or in other DC to DC conversion topologies that either require a full bridge or two separate half bridges. What is remarkable about the design process is the extensive use of virtual prototyping. The simulation tools allowed us to cut down the cycle loop times from first prototypes to the final product. And the biggest benefit being that a full analysis of the module regarding the parasitics and the couplings inside the layout was possible, and that these results and learnings could be fed back into the final module layout. The final layout was a deliberate choice of several aspects influencing the module performance and the module behavior. So we can say that the design targets that we set of having a good symmetry and also of controlling the parasitics in such a way that they benefit the module performance have been successfully reached. Moreover, the low inductance for a frame-based module of just 15 nanohenry allows to unleash the potential of the silicon carbide chips and to use them in fast-switching, low-inductive environments. Besides this package, there are of course many other industrial modules. There are silicon carbide optimized pinouts that can be customized and tailored to your application. To fully understand the lineup of products of Danfoss Silicon Power, please contact our sales representative. With that, I would like to end my presentation, and I'm available for questions through the digital conferencing platform. Thank you very much for your attention.